Happy Easter. Easter isn't just a day. Easter is a season of time when the living presence of Jesus now lives on through us. In our Bible, the early church was described in this way. Day by day, as they spent much time together in the temple, they broke bread at home, and they ate their food with glad and generous hearts, praising God and having the goodwill of all the people. Over the next few weeks, we are following our ancestors' traditions. We are creating a temple of worship in our hearts, whether we can be physically together or whether we're separate at our homes. But by sharing in words and music and breathing in the presence of God and thoughtfully being together, we stay connected. The earliest Christians worshiped in their homes before they had churches. So will we. Until we can meet again in our sanctuaries, we will worship together wherever we are. Because at the heart of the matter, we are connected through the Spirit that makes us one in the love we know in Christ. Happy Easter. Would you pray with me? Holy and living God, heartbeat of creation, help us to take this time to center on you, for you made us. You gave us life, and you continue to be with us each and every moment, each and every breath, each and every step. You, O God, you, O Christ, you, O Spirit, are with us. Amen.
Good morning. I'm excited to be able to share a children's moment with you today, something we haven't been able to do in several weeks. I hope that you're all doing well and continuing to smile and enjoy time with family. In the scripture today, we'll hear about the disciples of Jesus after Easter. We'll hear that they were afraid, and the best thing they could think to do was to lock themselves away in a room. I kind of get where they're coming from. But we'll also hear that Jesus finds them. That Jesus is able to be in that room with them, to comfort them, to say to them, "Peace be with you," and to breathe his Spirit onto them. This was a passage I didn't realize I needed to hear this week. I really needed that reminder that Jesus is with me. In those frustrating moments of learning fourth grade math, in those moments of having to figure out new technology and just not wanting to fiddle with it, even in the moments of pure fear and worrying about my family, Jesus is with me. He's with all of us, bringing his peace and his Spirit into our lives. But how do I know this? Okay, fair question. Jesus was certainly not at my breakfast table this morning eating eggs and toast with me. And I wasn't able to hold Jesus's hand yesterday when I took my afternoon walk. But I believe he's here with me. I know he's here with me. And we have a special word for this. It's called faith. Believing without seeing. Faith. That's where my pal Freddy's comes in. Actually, this is Avery's stuffy, one of her favorites she let me borrow. Can you guys see Freddy's? She put cute clips in Freddy's hair for his big debut on video. Now, I know you can't feel Freddy's, but he is so fuzzy and he is so soft, and I bet you can imagine how he feels. Now I'm going to lay Freddy's in my lap. Would you believe me if I said he's still here? Right here in my lap, even though you can't see him. This is like faith. Believing without seeing. Faith is easy sometimes. And sometimes it's hard to have faith. We get frustrated or confused, and I want you to know that that's okay. It's okay to wonder and to ask questions and explore with trusted adults. That's how our faith grows. When we share our Bible stories, when we come together as church, when we share love with our friends and our neighbors, and when we see kindness in our communities, those are reminders that Jesus is with us. We can't touch him and we can't see him, but he's right here. In the laughing and in the playing, in the sadness, in the fear, in the anger even, Jesus finds us. He is here with us, breathing his peace and his spirit into our lives. Will you pray with me? Dear God, sometimes it's hard to believe in things we can't see. But like the air, we know that you surround us with your presence and your love. Help us to feel your peace, be filled with your presence, and live faithful lives. In your name we pray, amen.
I invite you to breathe with me. Breathe in and out. Breathe in the words, peace be with you. Receive the Holy Spirit. In, peace be with you. Out, receive the Holy Spirit. In, peace be with you. Receive the Holy Spirit. Hear now these words from Scripture. It was still the first day of the week. That evening, while the disciples were behind locked doors because they were afraid, Jesus came and stood among them. He said, peace be with you. After he said this, he showed them his hands and his side. When the disciples saw the Lord, they were filled with joy. Jesus said to them again, peace be with you. As God sent me, so I am sending you. Then he breathed on them and said, receive the Holy Spirit. John 20, 19 to 22. Breathe on me, breath of God. Fill me with life anew. That I would love as thou would love, and do as thou would do. Two things Jesus wanted his disciples to have in that moment of fear: spirit and peace. Taking a breather is one of the ways in which we can see what Jesus offered them. He wanted them to take his breath so they would feel his spirit living in them. Breathe in the breath of God. Many of you have heard me say that a time or two, because it is true. It is faithful. It is what the disciples were being encouraged to do. It is what we're being encouraged to do today still. Just breathe. Divine moments happen when we breathe in the breath of God, when we stop long enough to catch our breath, when we change our focus, when we alter our perspective just enough to gain some clarity. We all need to take a breather, don't we? Clear the head, calm the tension, take some control in the moment. Find that sense of peace that Jesus wants us to have and to live from. Just breathe. We know how to do that. Go outside, take a walk, step away from the project. Do something that brings you joy. Just breathe. Leave the situation. Practice yoga. Exercise. Drift off to your happy place. Take a nap. We center ourselves, and we dip into that well of peace that is always there waiting for us. And amazingly, even if we don't intend for it to do so, It becomes a practice that tends to our spiritual well-being as much as it does our mind and our body. Through this time of sheltering in place, it has been so neat to see the various offerings that people and groups have offered for others to stay engaged, entertained, connected. There have been so many classes and courses offered on the internet, even from Ivy League schools. I decided to take a class. What a great opportunity to better myself during the season of Lent. But I couldn't decide. I couldn't choose whether I wanted to take a foreign language, or if I wanted to learn about world religions, or if I wanted to immerse myself into the math or sciences. I couldn't choose. And it got overwhelming, and I got anxious, and I had to remind myself, just breathe. And I was getting ready to step away for my sanity's sake, and I saw a headline for a class name that caught my attention. And this course was Learning How to Learn. Learning how to learn? I'm having a terrible time figuring out what to learn. So maybe before I can run, I need to learn how to walk. So maybe before I can learn what to learn, I need to learn how to learn. It was like an epiphany moment for me. So I enrolled in the class, Learning How to Learn. Our brains are amazing things, and we're always learning. Did you know that there are two kinds of modes that our brains utilize? Focused learning and diffused learning. Our minds are not capable of practicing both at the same time. Focused learning is the obvious practice, taking in information. It's what we do most of the time, most of our sleeping or awake and conscious time. Where we devote our attention to a certain thing. We spend most of our time in our focused thinking mode. Our short-term memories are forged here. Now, diffused learning is the big concept, seeing from a broader perspective, drawing upon previously learned concepts, ideas, and memories. Allowing ourselves to go into diffused state of thinking is where concepts and ideas can truly germinate. Be with us for the long haul. It's where ideas really settle in. 25-minute sessions of focusing our attention before taking a break or doing something else is really important. I learned what's also important is sleep. Sleep is key because our brains change over from a focused thinking when we sleep or nap or rest to this diffused thinking. So if you find your ability to be productive in the morning or after a nap, this is why. Our brains breathe. Figuratively speaking, you go into a different mode. Surrealist painter Salvador Dali was quite an eccentric fellow. He had a pet ocelot. He was a wild and crazy guy. He had a great technique for coming up with his paintings. He would relax in a chair. He would allow his mind to go free, often still vaguely thinking about what he had previously been focused on. He would hold in his hand a key, and he would drop that hand by his side as he would breathe in and out. And just as he would enter that dream state, he would drop his key and it would clatter on the ground, and he would wake up and he would go back to painting. But he would go back with this new focus mode at work, with those new connections that he made still fresh in his mind. Just breathe. Take a step or two outside. Breathe in the fresh air. See from a new perspective. Solutions rarely come when we are knee-deep in the middle of our problems, when we're focused on what is in the midst of. So step away. Change perspective. Then go back to it. We get consumed, we get tunnel visioned, we get fixated and stuck. There was a reason that Jesus would teach in parables and then explain it to his disciples later. and then explain it again on down the road. But here they all were now, huddled in a house in fear. They were consumed. They were stuck in their grief. They couldn't see beyond the situation. Even though Jesus talks to them and tells them death would not contain, that he would rise, they still needed to focus. They needed to refocus, and they hear and see Jesus present with them, saying, "Peace be with you." And then Jesus did the breathing. He breathed upon them. He wanted them to take his breath so that they would feel his spirit living in them. Only then could his disciples go forth loving as he did. Only with this breath of spirit upon them would they be able to break free from the fear and isolation and proclaim this new thing that God was doing through Jesus, doing through them. Peace and spirit. What a gift that Jesus brought to them in resurrection. What a gift that he brings to us. New life is still with us. We are connected. That is the spirit in our lungs. We are not alone. The promise of God, the peace of Christ, the nudging of the Spirit leading us into new ways. Just breathe. Breathe in. Peace be with you. Breathe out. Receive the Holy Spirit. Peace be with you. Receive the Holy Spirit. Amen. As we come before our God in a time of prayer, sometimes the best way to do it is just to sit in silence, to not have the words to lift up to our God, but to breathe in the Spirit and trust that peace of Christ to give us the people we need to be thinking about in prayer. So let us sit for the moment and allow God to put on our hearts the loved ones we need to be thinking about in this moment. Let us pray. Prayers for the people we love and care about. But we add to that list people we don't know, for the stranger who is hurting, for the person who is grieving the death and loss of a loved one, for the person who longs for the courage to leave a difficult situation, for the doctors and nurses, paramedics, firefighters, police officers, chaplains who are all on the front lines to see your people through their difficult times. For people worlds away, for all of creation, for wherever our hearts and thoughts may take us, God, once again, put into our thoughts and beings that which you would long for us to continue to be in prayer about. Continue to breathe your spirit upon us. In our fear and in our doubt, may we receive the living presence of our Christ who stands among us saying, "Peace be with you." May that which we feel this day continue to be a sense of your peace. May in our silent moments this day, O God, may you place and whisper a prayer of peace for all of your creation into our hearts. For that is at the heart of the matter, that Christ lives, that his Spirit reigns, that resurrection is possible for us and through us. God, you are here, and your people of faith pray. Amen. Stand here before our holy table, and I breathe in the breath of God. Three distinct smells fill my nose. The Easter lily, fresh baked bread, and the cup of juice poured out. Three distinct flavors all on their own that take me to a different place, to a different memory, to a different time, but three smells that when they come together, bring me to this table. Bring me to Easter. Bring us all to a time of trusting and knowing that resurrection promises have come true. So whatever grief and sadness and pain we bear this day, we also come with a sense of hope, a sense of expectation, a sense of longing, for Christ is with us. There will be peace. And so we journey with Jesus and his disciples to that night when they gathered in the upper room, when Jesus took bread, when he blessed it, and when he broke it, and when he gave it, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." We take the cup, which he blessed and poured and offered, saying, "Take and drink, for in this cup is a new covenant poured out for you for the forgiveness of sin." We too come to this table knowing that our Christ is present among us, knowing that there is peace in, for, and through our hearts. Would you pray with me? God, as we sit in our homes, we breathe in those smells of Holy Communion. It could be the smell of eggs and bacon and toast and coffee. It could be the smell of toothpaste or aftershave. It could be the smell of freshly mown grass. God, whatever it is we smell right now, it is the smell that binds us together, knowing that we are a people of table, knowing that our experiences become one as we join with our Christ in this Holy Communion. Our Christ who takes that ordinary and makes it sacred and special. So we take those common elements from our breakfast table this morning, O God, and we ask that you consecrate them. As we take the bread and cup, may we trust and know that the Spirit of our Christ dwells in it through us. God, in this sacred and holy feast, we know that you are with us, that you send us out in the name of the one who gave, who sacrificed, who blessed, who resurrected. May you bless our Holy Communion, O God. May you bless the acts of ministry that come from us in the days ahead. We, your people, go forth in love. Amen. invite you where you are to take the bread and take the cup. Sit in a sense of silence and listen for the Spirit to breathe upon you peace. As we prepare to go forth from this place, I want to thank One License for granting us permission for Jan to play the beautiful music that she has played for us this morning. Our license number is 732-161A. I also wish to thank you for your gifts and offerings, your donations to continue to keep the wonderful ministries of Raymour Christian Church going. We could not do this without you. So many thanks for mailing your offerings in and going onto our website and clicking on the offering link. Receive this benediction. God, you are with us. No matter what we go through, whatever hardships we face, you are standing beside us, whispering those words, "Peace be with you." God, you are good. You are present. And in our Christ, all will be well. Amen.